Hello everybody, and welcome to another lecture on computer architecture. Today we're going to take a look at MIPS instructions or operations, and it's going to get quite interesting, complicated. So bear with me, if at first you don't understand it, just play the video again, and I hope that at the end it will all become clear. I will give an example, calculate or construct an example of an adding function, and you will see that actually it makes sense, but it's quite complicated. It's like a puzzle. Let's again go back to where we were. We had this MIPS architecture that consisted of everything 32 bits, so we couldn't call it 32-32 architecture. It consists of 32 registers of 32 bits. So we have, this is the pieces of information that we have locally to our disposition, and we can shunt them around. We can just like slush them, we can put them back, forward, add, subtract. So constantly what we're doing, we're taking basically two of those registers information. Those are the source and the target. We put them in the arithmetic logic unit, do some operation with them, and then store the result into one of the registers. That's the destination register, RD. So source, target, do something, and place it in the destination register. Every now and then we can also place things outside the processor in main memory, like load word, store word, and things like this. But most of the time we will be inside here in the processor, that is everything here. And apart from these 32 registers, we have the program counter and we have the instruction register. So the instruction register explains every instruction or every operation is actually specifying what to do, and that is done by the opcode. It is then also specifying on what to do it, and these are the operands. So the operands are source, target, and destination, and the opcode specifies what to do, and the total is the operation. An operation is an opcode plus operands. So also the first thing to observe is that MIPS is a reduced instruction set computer, meaning RISC. And that means that you have a limited amount of operations that are available. Basically, MIPS has 64 basic operations. So 64, 2 to the power 6 is 64. So you have 6 bits for specifying the operation you want to do. And this is called the opcode. So 64, we have 64 operations, and they are divided into four classes, or actually we call them six, or how you want to call it. But for the moment, let's forget about FR and FI, because they are for floating point operations. So forget these two here, FR and FI, and also forget the pseudocode, because the pseudocode is actually just a actually not the hardware that is doing it, but is the compiler or the assembler that takes that function, like we've seen last week in the Hello World. We've seen that load address actually doesn't exist. It is doing it in two steps. The compiler is translating it into two real operations. So what remains then is for the moment is these three types of instructions called R, I, and J. R means registers. So basically, the operands are in registers. The source, target, and the destination, in principle, are in registers. To contrast this, we have the I instructions, or immediate instructions, in which one of the operands is in the instruction itself. And these things come in very handy. For instance, when we want to implement a for loop, for I equals 0, I smaller than 10, I++, well, we've all written this, remember? Then what we can do this in implement this in MIPS is that we, for instance, put the I in the T0 register and then add 1 to that register and place it in the destination register, which is also T0 or T1. So in this way, we can have that the value that with which we want to increment our variable is actually inside the instruction and not placed inside a register. So basically we have these three instructions. But I think this is best, the types of instructions. I think it is best explained by an example. So we're going to do something very complicated now. I'm going to show to you how we can translate. Imagine we have to do by humans have to translate the instruction. So this is actually how it was done before. Before we had compilers, humans had to do the translation of the instructions. So I'm going to give you here an example. Imagine I want to do, I want black. Here I want black. For the moment I want black. It blocks again. I have to wait a little bit for some reason. I want to do add destination is T2, target is T1, and the source is T0. Remember, the Mars assembler takes this format, destination, target, source, always. So we have to look at it where how to translate this into machine language. And machine language is zeros and ones. So the first thing you have to do is, I have here a reference card. This is from my own book, which I put here. I put, as you can see here, this is the format, which I will leave here above me. And then we have here the instructions. So here we have add. Add is what is called, where is my mouse? This is what we call a mnemonic. Mnemonic is a human readable form of writing the opcode. So in this case, we have the mnemonic add, and that is of course not understandable by computers. It needs an opcode, which is a binary number, and a binary number of 6 bits, because we had 64 possible operations. So we need 6 bits to specify this. 2^6 is 64. So this is the format, how it is written in assembler, and then this is what it's doing, and then I will do it on the book. It is then on the other side, the right page. Here I will just scroll. So what do we have? We have here, we have add, and then it says there, okay, the format of the instructions is R. I have placed here, R is 6-bit opcode, and then specifying 3 operands, 3 registers, then some immediate, there is still some immediate value there, which maybe or not we will use, and the subfunction of this instruction. Okay, so now we have to specify, now first we have to do opcode. What is the opcode? We have to write here 6-bit, and the 6-bit is hexadecimal 0, 6-bit, the hexadecimal 0 is also 6-bit, oh, I want to put a little bit more place, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That is the mnemonic is add, the opcode is 000000, as we can see here. Then this field A, what does it contain? Well, it's 5 bits, I'll show in a moment, and it's a target register. And it's 5-bit because, let's see this again, I want to hear this one. Remember, we have 32 registers, so to specify one of them, we need 5-bit. 2^5 is 32. So the register 0 would be 00000, and register 31 would be 11111. But which one do we want actually? We want, what do we have to do? In A, the first one to specify 5 bits here is the target register. Target register. Target is T1. What is T1? What is the binary value of T1? Well, remember the lectures on the registers. T1 is actually register number 9. So I have to specify 9. How do I specify 9? In binary, 5 bits. That is 01001. Then what do I have to specify? The B field here. B field actually contains, let me see, it contains the source. The source is T0. T0 is, if T1, this one was T1. If T1 is 9, then T0 is 8. So I write here 8. 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. That's 8. That is this one. And then the final, the C field here, is the destination register. That's destination register is T2. Well, T2 is 10. We can take a look at it here. Registers, indeed, T2 is 10. Yes. everything under control. So what we need here is this T2. We have to write in binary. We have to write 10. That goes here. That is 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. What do we have to write then? Immediate is also some kind of immediate. Sometimes this immediate value is used. For instance, do we have somewhere R with immediate? Well, I cannot find it so fast. Never mind. In this case, actually, this im value here is, in this case, is 0. It is from bit 6 to bit 10. Those are 5 bits. So we have to write here this immediate value is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That is im. And finally, we have to specify the subfunction of our instruction and the subfunction of our instruction of our operation is actually hexadecimal 20. Hexadecimal 20 in 6 bit from 0 to 5, these are 6 bit. So we have to write 20 hexadecimal in 6 bit binary, that is 1 0 0 0 0 0, that is 2 0 in hexadecimal. Okay, so now we have 32 bits. Let me see, this is 6 plus 5 is 11, 16, 21, 26, 32. So this is total, we have 32 bits. That is our instruction. But the only thing is, now I want to put it in hexadecimal because it's a little bit better readable. Of course, the computer will read this in voltages, of course, not in numbers. The ones and zeros don't exist, remember. But the voltages exist, and this is the voltage pattern that we have. But I want to write this in hexadecimal to see, also because the compiler, our assembler, also works in hexadecimal when it's writing things. So we have to translate this into hexadecimal. That was very easy, remember, just grouping the bits in groups of 4 and then translating it into hex. So these are 4 here, these are 4 here, we have 4 here, now we have 4 here, 4 here, 4 here, 4 here, and finally this. So it is hexadecimal OX, 0X. This one is 0, 1, let me see if I'm doing this correct. This is 2, 8, 5, 0, 2, 0. So what I'm saying, what I'm claiming, and we're going to check this in a moment, that the instruction that is human readable, which is assembler, add T0 to T1 to and put place the result into a register T2, or add T2, T1, T0, actually this translates into this bit pattern, that is real machine language, and this is, this thing here is what we call assembly. And this is the machine language that the computer understands. And this is somewhere halfway that I can still see it as a number and check if everything is okay. It's a compact form of writing binary code by machine language. So let's take a look. Where do I have? I already put here the assembler. And what we're going to write, only code. We do text, that is the code segment, remember. And what I want to do, add as destination T2, target T1, source T0. Let's compile this thing and see if it works. I hope I didn't write any mistake. No mistake. You see here the source code. Here, actually, it translated just the registers T0 into 8, T1 into 9, T2 into 10. And then what do we have? The final code is 0x, hexadecimal 01285020. And wow, that's amazing. That's exactly what I had written here. So that means that the calculation is correct. Our translation, human translation, is correct. So this is what I've been doing. I've been taking one specific example of a code of an instruction, and then did the assembling or the compiling. I did it myself. The translation into machine language I did myself, and it worked. So I hope you understand it. If not, just watch it again and see the magic happen. Or see you in the next lecture.